anyway, good afternoon. And first let me welcome all of you back to the Schimmel Forum. I've missed you. I think many of you have missed each other and Schimmel. And we have certainly missed our running commentary on world affairs and current happenings over this very newsworthy past month. Call it poetic justice, or perhaps more accurate, media justice, that we start our season today with a distinguished professor of journalism who is a robust commentator on the state of his profession, how it has evolved in recent years, and how and why it is under siege now. With regard to the siege, it was pretty shocking when President Trump's right-hand man, Steve Bannon, in an interview with CNN's Jake Tapper, advised the media to shut up. Tapper's reply was simply no. I promise that today's speaker will have more to say on that subject. Jay Rosen is a writer, press critic, and professor of journalism at New York University. He's been one of the earliest advocates of civic journalism, encouraging the press to take a more active and interest in citizenship, improving public debate, and enhancing life. His book, What Are Journalists For?, was published in 1999. His blog, Press Think, is about the fate of the press in the digital era and the challenges involved in rethinking what journalism is. In that regard, the original title for his talk was, as you know, The People Formerly Known as the Audience. However, something happened on the way to the Schimmel Forum. That is to say, he did add to his title the election of Donald Trump. Please welcome him to the podium.
What happened to the keyboard on this? Oh, here we go. Good afternoon. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. Thank you very much, Sandra Myers, for that introduction. Thank you for inviting me to the Schimmel Forum in this really beautiful room. It's my first time in Scranton.
Oh, welcome.
But I'm originally from Buffalo, which is the other end of the railroad, right? And so a lot of it feels very familiar to me, even though I left Buffalo a long time ago. Just a few words about me and what I'm going to do today before I show you a few slides. I have two specialties. One of the great things about being a college professor is you get to pick what you're working on. That's probably the best thing about being a college professor. Is nobody tells me what to do, I have to pick what I'm doing. Can you imagine that? So my two areas of specialty are the digital transformation and disruption of journalism, which has been going on for quite a while, and press criticism. So I write a lot about the press, what's wrong with the press, especially press coverage of politics. And so as you can imagine, the 2016 campaign and what's happened since Donald Trump's election have been topic number one. And I've written a lot about that. I study it. Some would even say I'm an obsessive about it. And so what I thought I would do today is combine these two things. The people formerly known as the audience, which is the title of something I wrote in 2006, is a big part of the digital transformation of journalism. And you'll see that it's connected to the election of Donald Trump. But since media coverage of Trump and the people formerly known as the audience are subjects that everybody knows about, this is not one of those talks where the scholar who's at the microphone has all the knowledge and you know a little bit. This is actually the opposite of that. Everybody has experience with being the people formerly known as the audience, as I'll show you. And everybody is a media critic. Am I right?
Yes.
And everybody has quite a lot to say on media coverage of politics and especially of Donald Trump. So what I'm going to do is give you 10 ideas to think with, and then we should have more than half the time for questions and dialogue. So let's get to it. That's my title. That's me. Okay, so the first thing to understand about the people formerly known as the audience is that the tools of media production, which used to be in the hands of the media companies, are now distributed to the population at large, mainly through this device. It is a fact of life that people can write, they can take pictures, they can shoot video, they can record audio, and they can publish anything they record to the world, which is an amazing thing. Because it used to be that only the media had the tools of media production. Now, if you remember your Marx, not Groucho Marx, Karl Marx, he said, when the means of production change hands, that's a revolution. Remember that? In media, the means of production have changed hands. They now reside in the hands of the audience, literally in the hands of the audience. In the sense that in theory, and sometimes in practice, you could record something you see happening on the street, like a cop beating a protester, put it online, and it could broadcast to the world. That is an incredible fact. So that's one thing that makes the audience the people formerly known as the audience, because everybody, in a sense, is a media producer. Growing up in Buffalo, I had access to a handful of news sources. Maybe some of you remember this. I'm looking at your faces, and I can kind of tell what generation you are. So there were three networks when I was growing up, plus a PBS station that was actually kind of hard to get on my television set. There were UHF stations, but none of them did news. So three networks, PBS. There was two newspapers, one of which died while I was in high school. My mother subscribed to Time magazine. That was really important to me. I remember reading about Watergate in high school in my mother's Time magazine, and I thought, wow, this is really important. It's the first time I got interested in the news was through Time magazine. So we had Time magazine, and that was pretty much it. Those were all the sources of news that were available to me when I was growing up, because there was a limited number of ways into people's homes. It was very hard to get a message into your home. You could broadcast it over the media, which was a very limited number of channels. You could broadcast it over radio or TV. You could try to send a print publication to the home, right? Which was maybe one or two of those that most people had. Or you could knock on people's doors and say, I have a vacuum cleaner for you, for sale. And that was pretty much it. And now with a single wire, or even wirelessly, the entire media universe comes to your home. So people have more choice. They have available to them all sources of information that are published on the internet are equally available to every user of the internet. See what I mean? Every page is equally available to every user. That's amazing. There used to be a store in Times Square, not there anymore, that had out-of-town newspapers. Can you imagine that? You could go to this store on 42nd Street between Broadway and 6th Avenue. I remember it very clearly. And you could find, like, the Dallas Morning News in New York. You know, the Portland Oregonian in New York. It was incredible. And now, that amazing thing, which existed in one place in New York City, is now the fact of life for everybody, right? So people have more choice. The audience also has more power, partly because the tools of production have changed hands, as I explained, partly because people have more choice. If you have more choice, you have more power, right? But also for other reasons. I'm sure you recognize the phrase on demand, right? On demand, just that little phrase tells us something right there. On demand means I want the program when I want it, where I want it. That's what on demand means. And now if you're not on demand, you're like not meeting the expectations of the audience because the audience has much more power. So just the whole idea that things are available on demand is a shift in power. When I grew up, I sound like a grandfather now. When I grew up, you watched the program when it was on. Remember that? I remember like when the program Batman came out, it was a big sensation. And I think it was on Tuesday night, and Tuesday night was controlled by the fact that everybody wanted to watch Batman, right? Now you just watch things when you want to watch it because the power has shifted to the audience, right? So the audience has more power. The audience has also been de-atomized. That's not a word we usually use, but it's the best word for this particular thing that I'm trying to describe, and so I'm going to use it even though you don't like it. De-atomized means that when people were part of a mass audience, which was a normal thing for like 100 years, they were reached by the media in a vertical fashion or top-down fashion, and they could be broadcasted to, but they couldn't talk back, right? When you're sitting there in your house and you're watching Walter Cronkite, how many of you remember Walter Cronkite? Yeah, amazing guy, right? And Chet Huntley. Remember him? When you're listening to Walter Cronkite, he can talk to you, but you can't talk to him. And that was normal. We thought that was normal. Actually, it's kind of weird. Right? Not even parents are able to do that with their kids, right? So that whole idea of they can talk to us, we can't talk to them, that was a property of mass communication. But it wasn't just that. It's that when you were being televised to, and the same would be true for listening to the radio in your car. When you were being televised to, you're connected up to the network, to the White House, to the Super Bowl, to the hockey game. But you are not connected across to other people. You see what I mean? You're connected vertically, but you are disconnected from all the other people who are watching Walter Cronkite. That's just part of how mass media works. So that's what I'm calling atomization. So now, with the internet, which is much more flexible, we still use the internet sometimes to connect up to powerful people. You can go to whitehouse.gov, and you are connected to the White House. Right? You can watch streaming video, which is connecting you horizontally, vertically. But at the same time, through texting, through social media, through your phone, you're connected to other people whenever you want to be. So this fact is changing the audience because the audience is now as connected to each other as they are to the media. So for example, when your daughter watches the Academy Awards, she's not only watching the Academy Awards, she's also texting to her friends. Simultaneously, right? That's called the second screen phenomena. So that's being connected up and it's being connected across at the same time. Make sense? So now the audience is in touch with each other while they are experiencing mass media, and that's a big difference. So the audience has been de-atomized. Another really important fact about the audience today is the falling cost for like-minded people to locate each other and realize how many of them they are, find spokespeople to talk for them, and discuss among themselves. So when you have a special interest, when you have a problem, when you have a passion that you want to share with other people, it used to be hard to find people who shared that passion. I used to work at a hot dog stand called Pat's Hot Dogs on Sheridan Drive in Buffalo when I was a teenager. And every Thursday night, they had classic car night. And people who were really into restoring classic cars would just come to this drive-in and just hang out with their cars and talk to other people who were as fanatic about old cars as they were. And that was the only way that you could find out who people were who shared your passion, is to show up in person. Now, with the internet, it's like simple to find people who think like you do, which could be a common political outlook. It could be just a common pastime, hobby. Or it could be something more serious, like families that are all struggling with a kid addicted to opioids. They don't just talk to other people in their community who might be facing the same things. It's very easy to find people online who are facing the same problems. There are probably a Facebook group, probably 10 Facebook groups we can find for that very thing within a minute. And the ease of finding people who are like-minded allows people to form new kinds of associations and to realize how many of them there are. The most politically awakening thing that can happen to somebody, oftentimes, is simply the discovery, I'm not the only one. Has that ever happened to you? We're not the only ones who have this problem. We're not the only ones who think this way. That's a very powerful thing. So the fact that the cost for like-minded people to locate each other, realize how many of them there are, is falling and has been falling continuously through the internet is a very important fact. So people in the audience can find each other more easily. The famous Philadelphia department store founder and mogul, John Wanamaker, from the 19th century, said something really important about media once. We don't know for sure if he said it, but it doesn't matter whether he really did or not. What he's supposed to have said is, 50% of my advertising money is wasted, but no one can tell me which 50%. Think about this. It's a very important idea. So what he's saying is, in order to reach the people who shop in my department store in Philadelphia, I have to place these big advertisements in the Philadelphia newspapers. Remember that, when the newspapers used to be dominated by the big department store ads? And he understood why he was doing that, but he also knew that at least half of the people to whom those ads went were never going to come to his store. And he was frustrated by this, because he only wanted to pay for the people who were actually in the market. You see what I mean? So 50% of the money I spend in advertising is wasted, but no one can tell me which 50% means that he has to deal with an inefficient medium. He has no choice. And in fact, that was the situation for anybody who had to advertise in a newspaper over a very long period of time. In fact, most local newspapers in the United States, penetration rate in the 1960s, when I was a kid, was 90%. That is, the big newspaper in town reached 90% of the homes in that region. By the 1990s, that figure was down to 50%, in some cases under 50% of the homes were reached by the newspaper. And during that time, between the 60s and the 90s, the rate that the newspaper charged for advertisements went up. Went up. So how could it go up when it was reaching half of the homes that it once reached? How's that even possible? Well, it's only possible when you have a monopoly. So Wanamaker was complaining about this monopoly, and he was complaining about how inefficient it is to advertise through the newspaper. Why am I telling you this? Because the internet is solving that problem. What Google and especially Facebook are really good at is finding the people to whom your advertising message should be going and only sending it to them, and then only charging you for the people who are actually in the market. So they're starting to solve this problem that Wanamaker was complaining about, because they are much more efficient at reaching people. How are they able to do that? Basically, by collecting tons of information about you. And because they have so much information about you, they know whether you have a backyard pool and whether you should be reached by the person who's trying to advertise to people who own backyard pools. Right? So the audience is addressable now in a way that it wasn't before. What does this have to do with Donald Trump? You have to stick around for the end of the talk to find that out. Anyone can reach the audience now without going through the media. Now, to some extent, this has always been true, or been true for a long time. What was the fireside chat? FDR's fireside chat. He went around the press, and through the radio, he went directly to your home, right? So that's going around the media. But in order for Franklin Roosevelt to do that, he had to demand that the radio networks broadcast his speech, just like presidents have always had to ask for prime time to address the nation, right? So you still have to go through, you have to commandeer the media to go directly to people. But now, anybody can do that. So anybody can go around the media, and that's what going viral is. If you have a clip that's on your Facebook page and it goes viral, what does that mean? It means it's being distributed to thousands, hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of people without the media being involved at all. So anyone now can reach the audience without going through the media, and that has made the media less powerful. This is a fact I'm having a hard time getting my mind around, so I'm dumping it on you in the hopes that maybe, you know, maybe you can help, or you can figure it out where I cannot. But the fact is that because anyone can reach the audience without going through the media, because people have so many choices, informationally speaking, because sharing is as important now, sharing is horizontal. I send you an email, hey, check this out. That's horizontal, right? Sharing is as potent now as broadcasting. People can believe what they want to believe. And if they consider it true, all intents and purposes, for them, it is true. Which has led to something very disturbing that I've written about called, I call it verification in reverse. So verification is when we take something that might be true and we nail it down with facts, with documents, with interviews, with evidence. That's verification. The most important thing that journalists do is verification. The most important question that journalists ask is that really true? That's why we need them. That's what their job is. That's the reason they have any social function at all. So verification is taking something that might be true and nailing it down with facts. Verification in reverse is taking something that's been nailed down and introducing doubt about it, which then releases a lot of energy, controversy, furor, resistance, pushback. And then you use all that energy to power a political movement. What does this have to do with Donald Trump? That's how he launched his political career, as a birther. Taking a fact, Barack Obama was born in the United States, that had been nailed down. There are documents showing it. Introducing doubt about it. The doubt creates a lot of energy, a lot of controversy, a lot of emotion. Then you try to bottle or leverage that emotion into a political momentum, which is how he started his life as a national politician. So that's verification in reverse. And it depends on the fact that people can call true any damn thing, excuse my language, that they want to consider true. And this is a big problem. This is not just happening in the US. It's not just a Trump thing. People in Europe are noticing the same thing. Somehow, nobody quite understands it. There's some way in which reality has become a weaker constraint in politics than it used to be. And this is a very confusing and difficult development that, as far as I know, nobody has adequately explained, even though all of us can see symptoms of it in various ways. Okay, it's dangerous to assume you have authority with the people formerly known as the audience. And I can best illustrate this with an analogy. I think we have a couple doctors here, don't we? How many practicing doctors do we have here? Anyone? Okay, how many patients do we have here? A lot, okay. All right, so nowadays, if you go to your doctor and he gives you a medicine or a prescription or a course of treatment, you don't just receive it and say, "Thank you, doctor. I will take those pills faithfully every day." That's not how people operate today. Instead, they take the advice that they have been given, the course of treatment they have been given, or the prescription. They go home and they look it up online, right? And you find out about this medicine, and you find out about other people who have this condition, and you do a little research, and you find a page or a discussion group or a Facebook group where of people who know something about this. And as I said earlier, you have a lot more information available to you than you did before. Now, this changes your relationship to your doctor, because you are not as helpless as you were before. Right? You have more power. You have more choice. You have more information. And it's not that nobody trusts their doctor anymore. That's not true. That would be way overstating it. But they have a lot more means for questioning their doctor, right? You have it's a lot easier to ask questions because you have more information. And so if you want to have authority as a physician now, it's not that you don't have any left. It's not that nobody believes you anymore. But your authority has to change. You have to deal with patients in a different way. You can't just dictate to them. Nor can you just expect them to do whatever you say to do. You have to realize that they have more information. You have to engage with them in a different way. You have to converse with them. The power relationships have been equalized. Now, a lot of you are old enough to actually check and see if this is true in your own lives. Your own relationships with people who give you health care have changed. Now, doesn't mean that the medical profession has no more authority. It still has authority, still has a lot of power. Doctors still do well, they still get paid well. But in order to be effective, they have to change the way they communicate because people have more power. So this is true for journalists now. It's true for politicians. It's true for teachers. It's true for anybody who would stand up and expect to be listened to. You have to be more dialogic, to use an academic term. You have to be prepared for back and forth. You have to be able to deal with people who have a lot more information. Okay, so Donald Trump adapted to these things much better than Hillary Clinton. That's one reason he won. Right? He was better prepared for a world in which people can believe as true anything damn thing they want to be true. He thinks that himself. That's part of his worldview. He was extremely effective. Let's go back through my... He was extremely effective on Facebook with people who shared his message with other like-minded people, with people who produced their own Trump news and distributed it. Right? He was quite aware that people wanted not just a choice of candidates, they wanted a different kind of candidate entirely. They wanted somebody who broke all the rules of being a candidate. Right? And that's an expression of choice. He understood that people have the power to go around the mainstream media. And he used that to his advantage. He was very effective at getting people to share horizontally material and emotion about Trump, which many journalists didn't quite realize how strong that movement was because they weren't tuned into that horizontal movement of information. People who were pro-Trump were able to find each other on social media in a way that they wouldn't have been able to in the 1970s and 1980s. That was a big factor in his election. One of the things that his team did very well during the campaign was instead of putting all their money into broadcast ads on major TV networks, instead they put it into Facebook messages, which could be targeted at individuals who, by their prior behavior online and with Facebook, were known to be open to the kind of thing Trump was selling. That was a huge part of his campaign. Major reason that he won. Obviously, he used his Twitter feed, right, to go around the media and go directly to his audience, and he encourages his fans to do that. I think he himself is an example of that. And he was aware, as other politicians were not, of just how much authority the mainstream media and other politicians had lost with the audience. And so in many ways, he embodied all of these messages. Okay, that's my presentation. What do you have to say? Yeah.
Didn't Obama first start using the new media?
He did?
I think Trump learned from Obama because new media, Twitter, Facebook, all that was used heavily.
Yeah, sure. It's a continuation. I mean, campaigns build on previous campaigns. So what Obama was really, really good at was developing a database of people who were inclined to support Obama and gather information on them so that they could be advertised to, messaged to, et cetera. What Trump was even better than Obama at was using Facebook to take that individualized profile of voters and shape messages that they were inclined to accept and go directly to them. So it's kind of, in a sense, it's the opposite of mass communication. It's more like mass scale individualized communication or personalized communication. So in a sense, in a number of different senses, Trump's team just took what Obama did further and adapted it, you know, 8 years down the road. But yes, sure. Yes.
So I've been listening to you on the media.
And yes.
In their episode from last week, they had this kind of interesting conversation about the media and had people call in and say, do they want the media to be more activist? Should the media be more objective and these sorts of things? So I'm wondering on this, well, a couple things. One, on this 10-point scale, how is the media doing? Is the media doing as well as Donald Trump, or is it adjusting to meet how Trump has hit these points? And second of all, you began with this wonderful and a call to Marx's idea of revolution. How can we have a revolution in media, or how does this revolution look when, according to something like what On the Media was saying, that about half, or at least more than that, we still need outlets like the Washington Post, the New York Times, are kind of stalwart pillars of mass media in some way or another.
Right. Well, it's very important, I think, to divide what used to be called the audience or the electorate into roughly three groups. Trump's core supporters, which might be about a third to 25% to a third of the electorate, are already insulated from and detached from the establishment media. They don't trust it. They don't rely on it. And in fact, when something appears in the mainstream media, they're more likely to mistrust it. And they have alternative sources of information, like Breitbart, but there's others. But also, they have each other. Like, they exchange information. And so we already have about a third of the public that is kind of broken off and detached from the media system, the traditional media system, and very attached to Trump. So one of the things that he's trying to do is not just attack the media and get people to mistrust it. He's actually helped break off a part of the American public and make himself the source of information about Trump rather than journalists. So that's one group. Then there's another group, maybe around the same size, 30%, somewhere between 25 and 35%, who are already determined opponents of Donald Trump. And we see them in the streets, you know, at the protests. They're very vocal themselves on social media, as are his supporters. He's not trying to engage those people. He's not trying to persuade those people. Persuasion plays very little part, as far as I can see, in Trump's politics at all. Like that's sort of like a dead idea, or that's the past. So that's the second group. Then in a third group, I would call, and I talked about this on the media, the neither nors, the people, not necessarily centrists, I don't think that's the way to think about it. They're not moderates, I think that's a dumb term. But they're neither nor in the sense that they're not part of Trump's core supporters who only listen to him. They're not determined yet to be opponents. And with that group, I think what the White House is trying to do, although this may be conscious, may not be conscious, but with that group, I think Trump is trying to raise the cost of remaining alert and informed. Meaning that his communication style, his political style, is to create a lot of chaos, to make things very confusing, to make it really hard to figure out what's true and what's not true. That's why he says so many things from his podium and from his Twitter feed that you know can't be verified. And so if you can take that middle group and kind of drive it away from politics, then you can rely on the battle between your core supporters and your core opponents. And he actually wants that battle to go on. He wants polarization. He wants people screaming at each other. Because the more people who are screaming at each other from the left and the right, the more ugly and chaotic and uninviting political dialogue becomes, and I think that's a plus for him. So that's a long answer to your question, but that's what I see going on. But even if you don't agree about what he's trying to do, because a lot of people say to me, do you really think that's conscious? Do you really think that's a strategy? And like, I don't know. Maybe it could be unconscious. It doesn't matter. The effect is the same. But whether you agree with that or not, I think dividing people into those thirds is a really valuable way to look at the audience now. Yes, ma'am.
I'm sure I'm not the only one. In terms of communication, I've yet to hear Trump use a word larger than maybe fourth grade vocabulary. And I think that's another part of the problem, the lack of education for people who vote for him. They understood these short, simple, tweet eligible words. And if you look at his tweets, he's getting down to letters instead of words. It's scary.
One of the things that he's very good at is something that I first began to appreciate with CNN host Larry King. Remember Larry King? And Larry King, who was on TV for a long time, very successful for a long time. I saw him interviewed once, and somebody asked him, how do you think up the questions for your interviews? And he said, when I'm doing an interview, I want there to be no separation between me and the audience. So I just ask what the audience would ask. So I think this is actually a really good clue to communicators like Larry King and also like Trump. The goal is for there to be no emotional distance between him and the audience. So people don't feel that they're being talked down to. People don't look up, Walter Cronkite, right? John Kennedy. They don't see it that way. They see him as sort of on their plane. I think that's been very effective for him. Yes, Sandra.
the idea of something being true or not true, facts, you know, I don't mean ultimate truth, but the facts, is that obsolete to not care whether something is a fact or not a fact?
Is it obsolete to care whether something is a fact or not a fact? Is that like a thing of the past? I don't know the answer to this. I think this is like one of the most disturbing things about what is going on. Because it used to be assumed, and I have an explanation for this. It used to be assumed that the president damaged himself greatly if he said something that was untrue. And that wasn't a controversy. That wasn't something that like one party believed and the other one didn't. Everyone thought that. Now, I think part of the reason that we thought that, part of the reason that became part of the presidency has to do with the Cold War in this sense. Since the end of World War II, the American president has had the power to blow up the world. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That is a fact. It is a fact known around the world, and it's in fact known to Americans. And it's a very strange thing to have, right? I mean, if you suddenly had the power to blow up the world, you would probably be a little uncomfortable with that at the beginning. So we have terms that kind of refer to this in a way that make it seem a lot less disturbing than it is. So, for example, the president carries around at all times the nuclear football. You ever heard that phrase? Which is like this case that has the nuclear codes in it, which is what you actually need to launch the nuclear message. So the nuclear football, well, when you talk about a football, it sounds kind of like jocular, right? So this is my personal theory, that a president who can blow up the world is a very scary thing. And American politics, particularly White House politics, was constructed to make people feel better with that. So one of the ways that we do that is by, for example, informing you that the president has fantastic information. He always knows what's going on in the world, right? And if something happens, like in the Middle East, and it's important, we wake the president up at 3 a.m. That's what the ads about the 3 a.m. phone call are about. You know what I'm talking about,
yeah.
Right? So the president always has to be alerted when something of importance goes on in the world. He has the best advisors. He has the best intelligence system in the world, the CIA, the FBI, the NSA. And part of that is because America's the most powerful country about it in the world. But the other part of it is, in order to have this power, you have to have a lot of constraints on it. He has all these advisors. He has the military, right? So for 50, 60 years, we have constructed an image of the presidency in which the president is not only the most powerful person in the world who can blow up the world, but to compensate for that, he has the best information, he has the best staff, he has the best advisors, right? And he listens to them, exactly, and he listens to them. And now Trump is blowing that up. And his idea is very different. It's that if nobody knows what the president is going to do, that's good, right? If the president is a little bit like unpredictable, maybe even a little crazy, that's good. That gives him an advantage in negotiations. If, yeah, he might blow up your business, he might blow up your country, he might blow up the world. Actually, we want people to think that. This is how he thinks. And along with that, it's no longer that important if the president has all the best information and always knows what's going on and has, you know, a network of knowledge that he can tap into. So that's a big shift. That's like, the Cold War created this idea of the presidency, and now it's being undone in front of our eyes. Yes?
Obviously, we're all frustrated. What can we do? Do you have any idea
We can write letters. He doesn't read them. He doesn't read at all. What can we do?
Good question. What can we do? And I have the answer. No.
Besides shoot it.
No. Ezra Klein at Vox wrote something really good about this week. And the answer is basically Republicans in Congress. The American system was constructed so that one part prevents the other part from taking rash action. We learned that in grade school. Remember that? Checks and balances, right? So the device that the framers created for this situation, which they definitely anticipated, there's no question about it, they anticipated a demagogue, excuse the expression, we're trying to be accurate here, in the White House. So the answer that the Constitution provides is that Congress has to use its power to make the president do the things he won't do. But they're not doing it. Okay. So the answer to your question of what can we do is pressure Republicans in Congress, monitor Republicans in Congress, get people who are constituents of those people to write them, call them. And it's starting to happen. I don't know if you've noticed this, but when Republicans in Congress have town hall meetings in their districts now, they're turning into events. Because people recognize this. So the answer is that. It's like that the Republicans in Congress who have the power have to start using that power. Because the most dangerous thing that could happen is that they decline to use the power they have. They have the power to investigate, but they can decline to investigate. And so that's the easiest, I shouldn't say easiest, the most likely way that this situation is going to change is that.
They're all afraid of
I know, but they're also afraid of the mobs that are showing up at their town meetings. They're afraid of people as well. Think about it. Remember your civics, people. The House of Representatives is reelected every 2 years. So they have to be more responsive. So there is a design there for addressing this. The one problem is, and this is a problem with the American system, is that when there's a dispute between the branches of government, the Constitution does not provide a way to resolve that. So that and anybody who's studied the Constitution, any professor whose specialty is that, will tell you that that is the Achilles heel. So it almost happened during Watergate, like when the Supreme Court said, hey, you got to turn over the tapes. Sorry, buddy, but that's it. You got to turn over those tapes. Nixon agreed, but he didn't have to agree. He could have said, no, what are you going to do? Where are your tanks, Supreme Court? Right? He could have done that. If he had done that, that would have been a constitutional crisis, because there's no way in the Constitution to solve something like that. A lot of people think we could be headed to a moment like that. But for now, the answer to your question is Republicans in Congress. Next question. Yeah. Yes.
What do you see as the future of journalism when you're talking to a student today? Like, what does it look like 20 years from now? Is there mass media? Does this lack of trust in media, does this live beyond the Trump administration? Like, is that a present day thing? Do they maybe the trust come back after maybe all the promises are lived up?
Yeah.
Or like, what does it look like?
Well, the erosion of trust in journalism predates Trump by quite a bit. So it's in no way is he the cause of that or the driver of that. He's much more the exploiter of that. And he's trying to accelerate it using the platform of the presidency. There's no question that he wants to do that. Just a little pause here, a little tangent here. One of the reasons that he attacks the news media so much, I think, is that he knows, or his people know, that leaks are going to be a huge problem. They already are. You're already seeing leaks like you don't normally see in the first 3 weeks of an administration. But when you think about it, a leak is tricky from a trust point of view, because you don't know who's leaking, right? That's what a leak is. You don't know who's providing the information. You don't know who the source is. So you can't trust the source because you don't know who the source is. So what can you trust in a leak? You can trust the publication, right? You can trust the medium that's giving it to you. So if Trump is teaching his voters and the public not to trust the media, then it kind of neutralizes leaks. But here's what I try to tell journalists they need to start doing. And a lot of them disagree with me about these points. Some of you will disagree with me about it. I think the claim that the mainstream news media has always made in the US, going back to the days of Walter Cronkite, the claim that says, we don't have a point of view, we don't have a philosophy, we don't have an ideology, we don't have a starting point, we don't have any assumptions either. We're just telling you the news and giving you the facts, so believe it because these are the facts. That way of approaching people, that claim, that bid for trust, is increasingly mistrusted. I believe that is increasingly mistrusted. When you say that to somebody, the first thing they do is go, whoa, are you kidding? Right? And so it's a lot more likely that people will trust you if you say, not I have the view from nowhere, I have the voice of God, these are the facts, so believe them. But instead say, this is where I'm coming from. This is where I'm coming from. You can factor that in to whether you believe me or not. Right? So that's one thing they should do. Another thing is to emphasize that even though they are coming from someplace, that's not their job. Their job is not to have opinions. Their job is to do the work of reporting. So here's where we're coming from, and here's the reporting we did. Here's all the people we called. Here are the documents that we checked. We don't just sit on our butts and opine. We are out reporting. And I think one of the things that the journalism profession has failed to do is communicate to the American people that its people are on the front lines of the most dangerous places in the world. Every single day, hundreds, thousands of journalists are literally risking their lives to bring American people the news. It's happening right now, let's say, in Mosul. Right? There are reporters in the recently freed sections of Mosul walking around trying to report on what that city is like. Now, those people are morally in the same position as the firefighters who risk their lives to go into the building, the soldiers who go to trouble spots around the world, right? They morally speaking, they are in the same position. What I mean is they put their lives on the line for the public. They know they're doing it, and it's part of their job. So reporting and stressing reporting is a second thing. A third thing is I think it's very effective to say, don't believe us? Check for yourself. Don't believe us? Here's the data. Don't believe us? Here are the interviews we did. Don't believe us? Here are the records. Go look for yourself. Anytime you can say that, where you sort of allow people to rerun the experiment and see what they get, builds trust. Another thing that journalists have to do is say, what did we get wrong? We're listening. Did we get something wrong? Let us know. Because we need the knowledge you have. As much as we want to share the knowledge we have, we also need the knowledge that you have. And another fifth thing they should do is constantly be saying, help us investigate. Help us investigate. You're 1,000 eyes and ears. We're only 100. You know a lot of things we don't. You're in places we can't be in. And so using the people formerly known as the audience as helpers in a way is super important. And there are certain kinds of stories that can only be gotten that way. Finally, this they are doing is providing secure and safe ways for people to give you confidential information is really important. So if they can do those kinds of things, they can begin to turn this trust problem around. But it's not going to be easy, and at least a third of the electorate right now is completely lost to mainstream journalism. That is, even if they did all the things that I just listed, it wouldn't matter because they're not listening anyway. So that's a big problem. Yes?
Based on what you said and using your 9 points before you got to this one, why isn't the mainstream media calling Trump a genius instead of a madman? And they're playing catch-up, following the trilogy, you don't pray against the Pope, draw against the Lone Ranger, and you know the third. Why? Where's the mainstream media? Their credibility is at an all-time low, right with the Congress.
Right. First of all, I agree with your last point that the 2016 election, what happened and what the news media told us was going to happen, was a devastating blow to the journalism profession. Devastating in many different ways. And you see it every time Steve Bannon says, oh, these are the same people who got the election wrong. Why should we, you know, that just the ability to say that is, that's a big thing. So that's true. Secondly, I think most political reporters, if we had them here, do think, wow, how did he do that? I mean, they are amazed. They are amazed at what Trump was able to accomplish. And they occasionally will say it. So it's not that they lack awe for what Trump was able to pull off. They are stunned and awed and shocked by it. But I think one of the reasons that they are so antagonistic to Trump is what we talked about earlier, his total disregard for whether what he says is true. That's a shock, because even though they had accepted that presidents occasionally lie and all presidents spin, and there's always propaganda that you have to sort through, the idea that the president doesn't care whether what he's saying has any factual basis or not is a very hard thing to get your mind around. It's a shocking thing. And it's been shown so many times that I think they're a little stunned about how to deal with that. They also are still stunned and stung by the way in which Trump, throughout the campaign and continuing as president, has deliberately projected hatred at journalists, encouraged supporters to do the same, and literally said, these are the most low, honest, dishonest, disgusting people in the world. So when you do that, you know, you're not going to be that popular. Yeah. You know, it's not like that hard to figure out why journalists are hostile to Donald Trump. He is encouraging Americans to be hostile to them. So that's where we are. Yes, in the back, sir.
You have effectively made the point that although the audience has more power through access, it doesn't have more truth. The truth to Donald Trump is what's most personally advantageous to him. I think we often forget that he was the 11-year-old schoolyard bully that was sent to military school to learn discipline, but also to become more aware and more responsible to others. That was to be his first pivot. It didn't take. And so as he goes beyond school to a business career, he's going to act on instinct more than thoughtfulness. Movement he has is always toward wealth and power, particularly power. And so he never pivots. You know, he doesn't pivot later. You know, this is after the primary, people say he will pivot it.
No.
After the convention, he will pivot.
No, that's not going to happen.
After the election, he will pivot. And now, after the inauguration, he will pivot.
It's not going to happen.
So, this idea that he knows what he's doing with chaos theory and all of that, I don't think that's where it is at all. He's
okay.
Still the 11-year-old schoolyard bully.
Yeah, I don't know if he knows what he's doing.
Quarry.
Okay, yeah. I don't have anything to add to that, but I agree with it. Yeah.
I'm surprised that people don't talk about his psychological health. This man over here says he's a genius, and I believe he's a sociopathic narcissist. And I would suggest anybody that's online go to, as we did the other day, psychological evaluation Donald Trump. There are many, many people, psychiatrists, who are coming out, and I would say risking their credibility by doing that, to find out that with this type of personality, there is no discussion, there is no ability to have him change his mind. It is there. So if you approach it, what he is doing, looking at his psychology, then you will be able to predict what he's going to do and what he's not going to do.
I'm very familiar with this line of thought. That's all I'm going to say. Yep.
Is this... I think he sees himself as creating a religion. So perhaps in this place, in a religious-type movement, so perhaps in this place, what's the best way to convert people from different religions? That may be the journalistic approach to take. I don't know.
Possibly. I don't know. Yes.
I know I don't watch the type of program that his programs on television. I've never watched any of those. What I'm seeing today reminds me of this type of TV program. And I think that some of these people are simply, they're watching this TV program that happens to be our president.
Yes, well.
It's that level. It's down here. And it's not even middle. It's down in the gutter almost.
My mentor in graduate school, Neil Postman, wrote a book in 1985 called Amusing Ourselves to Death.
Called what?
Amusing Ourselves to Death, yes. And the argument of that book, which I can definitely recommend to you, is that the logic of entertainment is breaking out of the sphere of entertainment and beginning to overtake other adjacent spheres that where it doesn't belong. And entertainment is beginning to shape our education system, our churches and religious life, right?
With
the mega church and the music and right, commerce, sports, which is entertainment, but it's become like more of a show, and of course politics. And so his warning was that everyone was worried about George Orwell's prophecy in 1984 and losing freedom that way. But he said, we can lose freedom another way, which is amusing ourselves to death. And what he has to say in that book about entertainment overtaking politics is incredibly relevant
right
to what has happened in our country. So I recommend that to you. Other questions? Yes.
Picking up on your point about the third of the population that is sitting in the middle going,
neither nor is.
I'm checking out and going back to my Kindle. The media does itself no favors by responding immediately to every dead cat that he throws onto the table.
Right.
And he is a genius at throwing the dead cat on the table. Oh, I'm just going to get rid of Dodd-Frank, but look, I'll talk to Nordstrom.
Yeah.
He is, prestidigitation is a lovely word. This is all happening over here, but I'll distract you with the dead cat.
Yeah.
The media is going to lose that third of the population faster.
Yeah.
By knee-jerking it to every distraction.
Yeah, I agree and disagree about one point. Is a problem for the news media, for sure. And it's still, people in journalism are aware of this, they talk about it, but they're still very much inclined to chase the latest outrageous thing. It's very difficult to lay off of that. And also, they're in a situation that they never expected to be in, and this is weird, which is too much news. And the users of news feel that too. I mean, the audience feels that too. Again, the Cold War model of the presidency is you control everything. You control the message. You control the news. And the way you do that is by having one thing a day that you're focusing on and making sure as much as you can to address that line of the day, the message of the day. This became like normal behavior in the White House. Trump approaches the opposite. It's like so many things going on that nobody can even deal with how much news there is. And so chasing the latest outrageous thing that he said in his Twitter feed or some of these smaller things is a problem. And the press is caught up in that. I don't agree so much that Trump is a media genius. I hear this a lot. Lots of people say that, and he's presented as this sort of a wizard. I think it's something else, which is a lack of shame. In the sense that anybody can create spectacular media shows if they don't care how embarrassing it is, right? If you don't care that a lot of people are going to hate you, if you don't care that you're going to be made fun of, right? If you don't care that you are considered an outrageous figure or an outlier, if you don't care how ridiculous you look or how threatening you are, like with the release of that videotape in the summer, if you just don't care, then it's really easy to control media attention because you are a spectacle. And so things that are explained through the wizardry of Trump's media genius, I think, are better explained through having no shame. It's my personal view. You understand what I mean?
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yes?
I'm wondering if I can step away from Trump for a second to go back to your suggestions about journalism in the future. I think there's a lot of value to what you're saying about increased transparency and increased participation, but I'm wondering if there's also a tension. I think I've always, as a librarian, I've admired the journalistic practice of protecting privacy and kind of making a distinction between what's discoverable and what's newsworthy. So, for example, not publishing the names of victims of sexual assault.
Right.
And we saw with the WikiLeaks examples, radical transparency is not always effective in terms of informing the public.
Right.
So do you see a way to kind of find a balance between openness and participation, but also maintaining some of that gatekeeper role that was playing an important, that had value to it?
Right. Well, this is a complicated question. The gatekeeper role definitely had value. And there was a time when a scurrilous charge or something sensational but had to do with somebody's private life could effectively be kept out of public discourse because the people in the news business wouldn't report on it. That did happen. There was a time when that was real. And that started to end with John Kerry and the Swift Boat episode.
Gary Hart,
yes, except that Gary Hart's indiscretions were things that journalists, for the most part, felt should be part of the public record. They made that determination because Hart boasted that he was totally clean and you can follow me around. And so the contradiction and the hypocrisy in the minds of most journalists that fair game. But the Swift Boat attacks on John Kerry were different. Most journalists thought this doesn't belong in the election dialogue. But it got there anyway. Now, why did it get there anyway? Because of the first part of my presentation. Because control has been ceded to the people formerly known as the audience. So now you have a situation where you have to ask, is it effective to try and be a gatekeeper in a world where there are no gates? Now, maybe journalists should do that, but even if they decide, well, that information is going to be shared by other people, by people with lower standards than us, but we're not going to touch it, they could do that. But the problem with that is that if that information then gets into the political system, into the public dialogue, and it starts to matter, now all of a sudden they have to pretend that something is not happening, which is violating their other oath, which is to tell you what's going on. You see what I mean? So that doesn't really work, right? So what it comes down to is that the gatekeeper role was only possible because we had a media system with choke points. Now we don't. So journalists have to establish their authority in other ways. They can certainly have their standards about what's worthy information and what's not. They can continue that. But they're going to have to earn their authority in other ways, like being transparent, like being trustworthy in the ways that I explained today. It's just a lot harder. It's a lot harder to establish authority than it used to be. When you had all these choke points, it was easy. Now it's harder. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Last question.
That journalists have to adapt their standards. A personal inquiry. How have you altered your teaching technique?
Oh, a lot. Well, first of all, if you go to my site, Express Think, and you go to the FAQ section, you can find out what my politics are and, you know, where I'm coming from. I say there, like, if you have an image of a stereotypical Upper West Side Jewish New Yorker, that's me. Even though I don't live in the Upper West Side, I live in the Village. But if you, you know, so I just say, like, I'm exactly as you would expect. Like, all my opinions are exactly what you would think. But I don't parade my opinions around. I mean, I don't write about politics directly. I write about the media's coverage of it. But just being open about that I'm coming from somewhere is really important to me. Also, in my own teaching, increasingly, I don't lecture. That's why I only wanted to do like 10 points and then the rest of the time we have dialogue. So I try to be more dialogic in my teaching. I run a graduate program, master's in journalism focused on innovation in the press. And the way I teach is through projects. So we do projects with media partners. And so my role as a teacher is increasingly to set up the project, make sure the students have something very interesting and 100% real to work on, where they are given a problem like that the Wall Street Journal is having and they get to tackle it and return solutions to the news company. And so my role is to create that situation, give them help, be available for them when they get stuck, make sure they have the proper technical knowledge available to them, and they do the project. So that is a lot different than saying, I am the teacher, I have the knowledge, and you will be the receiver. You know what I mean? So yeah, so I have to adapt. And also, I am myself on social media all the time. I have 190,000 followers on Twitter, 160,000 on Facebook. So I do a lot of my work on social media with the people formerly known as the audience. And I'm constantly engaging with people on the social platforms. Not journalists, just people like yourselves. I don't want to call you regular people because you look exceptional, but just readers, users of the press system. I'm constantly in dialogue with them, so I'm in that way. I'm trying to model what I'm saying as well. Is that an answer? Okay. Thank you.
Making us think. That's what we're here for. Thank you.